Okay, so as an outline of my talk, there'll be an introduction about what puberty is, what is normal before we can talk about what is abnormal. There are specific types of precocious puberty that we need to know. How do we investigate this? The diagnosis that how do we actually diagnose precocious puberty and the types of precocious puberty, and what do we do with them? I will actually end hopefully with a case so that you can understand what's going on. So as a start, normal puberty in girls usually begins with telarche. So there are a few terms that you need to know. Telarche means the onset of breast bud. And then this is followed by puberty. Puberty means the onset of pubic hair. And puberty is generally caused by androgens and not estrogen. And the pubic hair may also be the first presentation of puberty in a girl. Gonarche is a term which is referred to the production of sex hormone, which is initiated by the gonads and not by your central, by your pituitary gland or your hypothalamus. So in most adolescents, what happens is from the first start of puberty, which is the breast bud, it will take about 4 to 5 years for its completion of the whole sequence of puberty itself, which basically ends with menarche. So what sort of endocrine changes and what happens in a girl? What triggers puberty? Okay, so we know way back many, many years before this that GnRH is basically released. And if the child is pre-pubertal, the GnRH is technically in a very low amplitude pulse and it's very low frequency. So it's basically sleeping, okay? So your GnRH pulses or your hormones is actually asleep. There's this hormone called kisspeptin, which suddenly appears, which we really don't know what the trigger is for, and this alters the GnRH amplitude as well. It causes it to be higher, and the frequency increases, especially at night. So as maturation progresses, what happens is these changes then extend not only to the nighttime but also to the daytime. And then with that, LH and FSH production begins, again mainly at night, and then after that again during the day. Alright, if that sounds a mouthful, like we have a little cartoon to hopefully tell you what's going on. So we really don't know what triggers kisspeptin, but kisspeptin is the hormone that initiates GnRH release in puberty. There have been evidence or postulations that leptin and ghrelin, ghrelin is actually secreted when you are hungry, and leptin is secreted when you are full. So people postulate that leptin and ghrelin triggers kisspeptin, kisspeptin itself triggers the GnRH release, and then that triggers the pituitary gland to release LH and FSH. Okay, let's look at a girl, because we're not talking about boys today. So what happens is the LH then acts on your ovary, and then it stimulates the estradiol to come out. So precocious puberty, so what is precocious puberty? Basically, it represents increased sex hormones production, either by the gonads, which is called independent, or dependent to the GnRH hormones. So over 90% of girls with GnRH-dependent precocious puberty have no identifiable underlying pathology. And then what do we mean by puberty itself? Basically, everybody's familiar with the Tanner chart. In girls, they're pre-pubertal, so we normally identify this as breast 1, BH1. When you have breast buds, which are noted or palpable, then this is called BH2. And then if there is further enlargement of the breast and areola, this is called BH3. 4 and 5 will be your mature adult. When the child is pre-pubertal, the girl is pre-pubertal, you don't expect any pubic hair. And then when they're about stage 2, they may have some sparse or minimal pubic hair. And then it progresses as the puberty progresses. So why is this important? So why are we here talking about precocious puberty? So what if someone gets her menarche early? Does it matter? Well, basically, all of us have got two times in our life that we grow really fast. One, when it's first 2 years of your life, you can your height or your the growth velocity is about 20 centimeters a year. And again, when you enter into the period of puberty, where girls will grow at approximately about 8 to 10 centimeters a year. Just why do they grow so fast? Basically, it's because rapid growth in the early onset is basically due to your nutrients. And then what happens is when you enter pre-pubertal period, you basically grow at about 4 to 5 centimeters a year, which is normal. And then as you enter puberty, there'll be a surge of sex steroids, and therefore this will make you grow faster as well. So in a girl with precocious puberty, what happens is this is accelerated. Instead of taking about 4 to 5 years to complete your growth, this takes about approximately about a year or so. And this happens very early on. So let's just say she's about 5 years old. So she completes her growth at around 5 to 6, whereas her other friends will continue to grow at a slower rate, but they will have time to grow, and therefore they will end up being much taller than her. And the reason why they stop growing when you enter puberty is because your epiphysis is also very sensitive to your sex steroids, and your epiphysis will therefore fuse, and there'll be the end of growth. Okay, so let's talk about variants of normal puberty. So we have got cases where mothers would come to us complaining of isolated breast development. So normally, this is called premature telarche. Is this benign, or is this something that's going to be progressive? The definition of premature telarche just means that there is an isolated breast development present by 2 years old. It's either unilateral or bilateral. Typically, this is benign. Because the child does not grow any faster, she grows at a normal rate, and there's also absence of other pubertal changes. If you look into her blood tests, you would see that there'll be a small increase in FSH. However, there'll be pre-pubertal levels of the LH and FSH should you do a GnRH stimulation test. So basically what we do is we just observe and reassure, although we do follow them up every 6 months as well. Premature adrenarche is basically the onset of pubertal androgens, which is a very common variant of normal pubertal development as well. It's characterized by acne, axillary odor, and also sexual hair. Sexual meaning axillary, pubic hair, or both. Basically, this is due to the androgens from the adrenal gland. In girls, it's easy to distinguish because you can obviously see the girls having extra hair and or the girls themselves picking it up. Although the boys, okay, we're not talking about boys, so I shall skip that. The boys really basically need to look further. So if the girls come to you with just premature adrenarche, we really, really need to look hard whether there is any other source of androgens, whether it's a tumor or whether the child or the girl has a adrenal hyperplasia itself. So basically, if we manage to distinguish premature adrenarche, there is something called premature pubarche as well, where the girls just present to you with pubic hair alone. And typically, this is quite benign. So what are the etiologies, or what causes precocious puberty? Okay, this is both in males and females. So there's something called GnRH dependent. So it's basically coming out, the signals are basically from central. So it could be idiopathic. We really don't know why. Some people say it's international adoption, meaning that there have been studies where children from third world country have been adopted to a first world country, and they are noted to have precocious puberty. Or anyone with a CNS insult. CNS insult can be anything like a previous brain tumor, cerebral palsy, hydrocephalus, irradiation, trauma, infection, and the whole list. Okay, or it could be hypothalamic hamartoma. Hypothalamic hamartomas are actually pretty common, and it's actually quite benign. I mean, benign, but they present to you with precocious puberty, and you need to treat that. Others will be your neurofibromatosis, your tuberous sclerosis, your Sturge-Weber syndrome, or if they had some chronic sex hormone exposure as well. GnRH independent females, McCune-Albright syndrome, or whether there's ovarian tumor secreting estrogen, ovarian cyst, or adrenal tumor secreting estrogen, or any other exposure to estrogen itself. So, basically, if you really want to be, you know, if you really want to define it, precocious puberty is basically breast 10 and 2 before the age of 8. But overall, there has been reports of girls developing breasts earlier on, earlier than the age of 8. So we have actually attributed this to the improved nutrition and also the effects of environmental endocrine disruptors as well. In the US, for instance, about 4.5% of girls attain telarche before the age of 7, and 8% of them by the age of 8. However, despite them having breast development early, their menses still remain to be the same, similar age. So they just have got a very sort of prolonged breast development before they attain menarche. It also seems to be that the African American girls tend to have higher or faster or early puberty as compared to the Caucasians. However, in Malaysia, we don't have any population studies, so our cutoff point is still 8. So as I mentioned, the sex hormone production by the gonads, either precocious puberty can be divided into GnRH-independent or GnRH-dependent, depending on where the sex production or sex hormone production occurs. Okay, so but as I mentioned again, GnRH-dependent etiology in girls, more than 90% of them, really, we don't really know why it happens. So let's just say that someone comes to you with precocious puberty. So we need to basically find out whether this is truly precocious puberty. Most represent a physiologic variation which does not really require anything. The most important thing is to look and ask for any height increment or whether there was a growth spurt. An examination includes inspection of the breast tissue to exclude also fatty tissue itself. If you have a look at the vaginal mucosa, if it's red in color, typically it's a pre-pubertal vaginal mucosa. And if it's pale pink, it indicates estrogen exposure. We also send them off for a bone age and also an ultrasound of the uterus to look for any progress of the puberty itself. What happens in the ultrasound findings is if the uterus looks tubular with no endometrial stripe, it's suggestive of a pre-pubertal state. Puberty state, as you all know, is pear-shaped and also endometrial thickness more than 3 millimeters. And if you do a random estradiol, you'll be more than 10 picomoles per liter, which is also partly one of the signs of puberty itself. So once we've established that the girl does have some pubertal change, we must make sure whether is this isolated telarche. So isolated telarche, as you know now, it's normal growth. There'll be FSH elevation, but pre-pubertal LH levels. There's no advancement in the bone age, and you may have some small ovarian cyst on the ultrasound itself. It's also, if the onset is before 3 years old, and also it's frequently, what happens is after the age of three, it may regress, but it may just persist, but it's not progressive. Usually, if the onset of telarche is above 3 years, so in between 3 to 8 years, there is a possibility that it may be progressive or it may be a form of early puberty. If the child comes to you with isolated puberty, like I mentioned, it's generally a benign condition, but we must need to rule out any other sources of androgen excess, like, for example, non-classical CAH or some adrenal-producing tumor or ovarian tumors itself. Sometimes the girls come to you with isolated vaginal bleed without significant breast development. Usually this is not likely to be due to an endocrine disorder. We must look hard for a local pathology or tumors, but we must make sure that this child has not been sexually abused. So we must rule out NAI itself. So once we've established that this girl has got pubertal changes, is this a GnRH dependent or is this independent? Because the treatment is different. So if it's dependent, it's a concordant progressive accelerated pubertal development, Concordant meaning there'll be development of breasts followed by pubic hair, followed by growth spurt, and then menses. So that is basically GnRH dependent. If it's discordant, meaning that you might the child might come to you with a PV bleed, and then within a year breast development, indicates that something else is a source of the estrogen. It could be a cyst, it could be some sort of syndrome, or it could be hypothyroidism itself. Why hypothyroidism? It's because the especially overt hypothyroidism, the TSH molecular structure is actually quite similar to LH. So it tends to sit on the receptors and flirts it, and your brain gets a bit confused, thinking that it's actually supposed to produce LH. And therefore you start having your menses. So GnRH stimulated gonadotropin levels remain the gold standard. So typically we subject these children to GnRH stimulated gonadotropin tests to differentiate whether it's actually dependent or independent. If you don't have that in your facility, what happens is you can do a baseline LH. So it's been shown that the LH is a better indicator of pubertal status compared to FSH. If your basal LH is more than 0.6 and your LH to FSH ratio is more than 1, it could be that this is a GnRH dependent precocious puberty. If your basal LH is more than 0.1, there is a 94% sensitivity and 88% specificity that is actually a GnRH dependent precocious puberty. So what do we do? In pictorial form, precocious puberty, yes, we have established that. We need to see what's the extent of the pubertal development. If it's complete telarche, just breasts, you must do a bone age. If the bone age is retarded, think of hypothyroidism. If it's normal, could it be a slowly progressive variant? If it's advanced, then you need to do a basal LH-FSH. If they come to you with isolated pubarche, then you need to look for the DHEAS levels. If you're isolated menarche, as I mentioned, you must need to rule out any eye or any sexual assault, and also look locally whether there's anything that may produce this bleed. If your basal LHFSH is low, so you don't know whether this is independent or dependent, then you subject them to a GnRH stimulation test. If there's pre-pubertal levels, then therefore it's an independent. If it's pubertal levels, therefore it's dependent. Usually we would send them off for MRI brain to make sure that there is no causal effect. If your basal LH is already elevated, so therefore you know that it's already dependent and you don't really need to go through the stimulation test. So again, incomplete variants, premature telarche, premature adrenarche, premature menarche, complete precocious puberty, either independent or dependent. Okay, isolated telarche and atypical precocity. If it's just isolated telarche, usually they are less than 2 years old. Atypical precocity, usually it's more than 2 years old. The growth for isolated telarche is normal. This is accelerated. Non-progressive for the telarche and progressive for the atypical precocity. If you take some bloods, high FSH for the isolated telarche, normal LH, and the other way around, high LH and a low FSH for the atypical precocity. Bone age will be normal in isolated telarche, advanced in the atypical precocity. Pelvic ultrasound will be pre-pubertal in isolated telarche, pubertal changes in the atypical precocity. Nothing required in isolated telarche. GnRH analogs is recommended in the atypical precocity. And if somebody comes to you with isolated pubarche, usually we send off testosterone and so DHEAS. If it's mildly elevated DHEAS, it's basically premature pubarche and you really don't really have to do anything about it. Elevated could be congenital adrenal hyperplasia, so we need to make sure that your 17 OHP levels are normal or elevated. If it's slightly elevated DHEAS and very much elevated testosterone, think of a tumor. If it's normal and a significantly elevated testosterone, think of an ovarian tumor. So what do we do with them? Why do we treat? Remember that we also, it's a psychological thing and also social implications as well. Especially if the girl is very, very young, people might take advantage of her as well. And also, most importantly as well, to preserve height. If there's an underlying pathology, we need to remove. Whether it's a tumor or, except for the hypothalamic hamartoma, which is basically a benign condition. And what do we treat with? We use GnRH analogs for dependent precocious puberty, basically because what the concept is to flood all the receptors, and therefore your endogenous GnRH isn't released. The treatment benefits those who are less than 6 years old with significant bone age advancement and also where the height is compromised. If the child is between 6 to 8 years old, normally I would allow or let the parents decide whether they want to stop the puberty or not. How is it given? It's given every month. There are preparations and 3 monthly preparations as well, but there have been issues about its effectiveness, the 3 monthly preparations. So we normally follow them up to look for pubertal advancement. It should stop. If it progresses, then we may need to modify the duration of treatment. It should be given less than 3 monthly, maybe 3 weekly. It doesn't affect any pubic hair or axillary hair because, as you know, that's androgen-based. And it's basically discontinued at 10 years old for girls. And menarche may be attained about a year or a year and a half later. So what do we have in the market? What do we use? We normally use triptorelin, which is a monthly depot, 3.75 milligram. There is leukoprolide. Some centers do use leukoprolide as well, and they do use the 3 monthly depot as well. The 3 monthly depot is useful, especially if the girl is very young, so you don't subject the child to repeated pain. But again, like there have been studies that say that the 3 monthly depot may not be as effective. So if it's an independent, GnRH-independent precocious puberty, actually this is one more difficult one to treat. If the child has a McCune-Albright syndrome, that studies say that we can use medroxyl progesterone acetate or tamoxifen. If it's a functional ovarian cyst, typically it will regress, but the biggest cyst, we'll need tumor markers and also follow-up. And if it's CAH, then we need to ensure the compliance with the medication, and you may need eventually GnRH analogs. So I thought I would just illustrate with a case. So this is a 2-year-old girl who had presented with PV bleed. Parents had claimed that the PV bleed started since birth. With just spotting, they wouldn't show the duration of each episode, but it continued every month for the first 6 months of life. And after 6 months, the child was noted to have PV bleed every 28 days. And when at 10 months old, it was noted to be obvious as per regular menses. So they brought to us at the age of 2. At that point in time, tender breast was about 3 to 4. There wasn't any pubic or axillary hair, and there were no significant findings of note, clinically that is. Other investigations, ultrasound showed uterus to be pubertal with thick endometrium. She did have some cystic left ovaries. Alpha fetal protein was low, beta HCG was also low. The MRI brain and pituitary gland was done, and this was normal. Bone age at 10 months was 2 years old, so she looked very mature. And so we did a GnRH stimulation test. As you can see, at time zero, LH was already very high. Estrogen was 184 without stimulation. And once we stimulated her, the LH was about 65.8, highest was about 85. Yep. And then as you can see, the ratio of LH-FSH is obviously more than one. So our impression at that point was GnRH-independent precocious puberty, idiopathic in origin, because we really didn't know where or how she progressed. So I only have her growth chart when she was 4 years old and above. So the blue lines is her height. The triangular red dots are her bone age. Her bone age. The parents' final height, the mom and dad final height for the girl will be 155 plus minus 8. So at 4 years old, she was very tall for age. Her bone age was here at about 8 years. So she looked like a 8-year-old girl, although she was 4. And then we actually started GnRH analogs at the age of 2. I don't have the height for them, so sorry. So I only have this. And she remained tall. The bone age didn't really change. In fact, at one stage, it went, it progressed. I think we made it, we changed the doses to a 3 weekly just to make sure that it didn't escape, like the GnRH analogs didn't escape. So they were very compliant as well to treatment because they have to come to the hospital to get the treatment anyway. And then as you can see, at the age of about, now she's about eight, her bone age is around 10. So should she continue here, she would probably hopefully end up just around her mid-parental height. So the parents and have agreed to stop the medication at their age of about 10 or so. But she is otherwise a well, clever girl who is very tall for her age, although now that she's already sort of entered the 50th centile for her height. So yeah. Okay, and then with that, with this case, hopefully it sort of illustrates what I've just told you. And with that, I'll thank you.